And good morning, everyone. 8:08 here on KFYO Mornings with Dave King and Matt Martin. And as promised, I think we have Congressman Jody Arrington on line one. Good morning, Congressman.
Good morning, Dave, Matt.
Good morning.
Yep. As always, great to be with you.
Well, I suspect we have quite a bit to talk about this morning. Of course, I guess the big news is of what's going on with the lawyer of Donald Trump and the invasion by the FBI of his home and office. Congressman, what's going on? We were talking on the show this morning. This is kind of becoming a little bit scary when you think about it. It seems like that this thing is kind of going out of control.
Yeah, I agree with you, Dave. I mean, I think I've got some real constitutional questions on unreasonable search and seizure. I want to know what grounds that our U.S. attorney in the Southern District of New York decided to raid this gentleman's office, just like we want to get to the bottom, and I think we actually have, on why Carter Page, one of our United States citizens, was surveilled by the intelligence community. It just feels like this is spiraling out of control with partisanship, and the deep state is alive and well, and I'm very concerned. The president's in a real bind because, you know, anything he does will be scrutinized as trying to obstruct, and it's Congress's job, and it's Jeff Sessions' job, our attorney general appointed by the president, to ferret through these things. I think we need an independent counsel over the whole lot of it.
And I have lost total faith in Jeff Sessions.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, he is such a strong, always been a strong, ardent law and order guy, not to mention conservative. And his recusal ever since then, it just seems like it's run amok over there and no one's really in charge. I guess except from Bob Mueller, and we're not even sure what's going on there, except that there's no evidence, and there's been no evidence after millions of dollars in a year in investigating. You can indict a ham sandwich if you just spend enough time and money, and yet we have nothing to implicate this president on the grounds of colluding with Russia. And so it just seems like this is an endless means to distract this president. And meanwhile, we're facing imminent conflict in the Middle East, again, with Syria, and then you've got the Korean Peninsula. It's just a shame that we're on these sidetrack, sidebar discussions and issues and not letting our president focus on the things that I think matter most.
Well,
to
Congressman,
Americans,
for
like
some of us,
security.
For some of us, we probably don't have a clear picture of this, but what it looks like, from my perspective, there's a whole bunch of people in Hillary Clinton's camp, and probably even Hillary Clinton, and the two FBI agents, and you could just go back and name a whole bunch of people. Why aren't they in jail? Why has nothing been done? And yet here we've got Trump. It's an endless parade of running him through the grist mill.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. Again, that's why I think you've got to take it out of the hands of the Department of Justice and FBI leadership. They've already proven to not be impartial because of this FISA warrant that was signed off by everybody, it seems, over there in the senior most positions. So I think they've all compromised their integrity by not disclosing where that dossier came from. At that point, when I read that memo before we released it, my first response was, we need an independent counsel to go back and look at the Hillary Clinton issues, and whether it's the Clinton Foundation or the email case, the server, private server issue, and we need to investigate the top brass at these agencies, where it's unfortunate, but they're the top law enforcement agencies in the land, and now the American people are saying, golly, is the deep state affected even the most impartial of agencies that we have to trust to mete out justice?
So as far as you had Jeff Sessions, he recused himself from this investigation because of how close he was to Trump. to President Trump. Now, when you look at Rosenstein, should he not have recused himself from being part of the FISA warrants that started this whole thing? I mean, wasn't he not part of the kind of the opposition research that went with that?
Well, I know that there were folks in the chain that should have recused themselves, but the bigger issue there, Matt, in my mind, is not a recusal issue. It's the fact that they knew the source of this information was political. They knew it was paid for by the Hillary Clinton campaign, the DNC, and they didn't disclose that to the FISA court.
Yeah.
So that to me is beyond nefarious. That's beyond unethical. These folks need to be investigated because there may be criminal activity at the highest levels in the Department of Justice. That's my biggest concern.
So at this point, and I understand you were talking about an independent inquiry into this, but what can be done? Is that the only thing that can be done at this point?
Well, there's an independent or a special. It's not a special counsel, but we've got an IG investigation, and we've got another sort of independent U.S. attorney looking at all of this. I believe we need a special counsel with the same scope and scale of resources and authority that Mueller has to investigate all the things that I just described, and the things going back to the Hillary Clinton email server scandal, because I don't trust that was objectively and professionally carried out now that we've got this new information, or relatively new. So I'm calling for a special counsel, as some of my colleagues are, but we do have things, investigations.
What are the chances of getting that done?
Well, I don't know, because you've got some who I respect a great deal on the Judiciary Committee saying it's actually better not to have a special counsel, but to have this special prosecutor. So these guys have been doing this longer than I have, and so there may be good reasons to have this U.S. attorney as an independent counsel and not a Bob Mueller-like investigation, regardless of the means. We just need to make sure that we go back over and look at and turn over every rock to see where there's corruption at our Department of Justice.
Okay. Congressman, we're going to go ahead and take the break, and we'll come back. We're going to ask you a few questions about the Syria crisis and maybe talk about the trade war with China.
And good morning, 8:20, and we are back live and back on the phone with Congressman Arrington. Say, Congressman, It seems like that the Chinese may have blinked on the trade war.
Well, I think the president's posture has been right on, and I know it makes some of our folks nervous, including our ag producers in West Texas, but a cheater is a cheater, and there's no benefit of free trade and free markets if people aren't playing by the same rules. We're not afraid of head-to-head competition. We win that every day and twice on Sunday. But you can't compete when you have state-sponsored fill-in-the-blank, aluminum production, steel manufacturing, crop production. So we either let them continue to put us out of the business of making things in America, or we stand up to them. And we do it, though, in a very targeted and measured way. That's the only thing I would – and that I have advised the president with other members is – make sure we mitigate the unintended consequences of other trade deals and partners that are not the bad guys like China. But I think he's right on, and I think we will win this if we just stay with that posture of strength.
So, Congressman, one of the things, my understanding is that China actually takes any technology that is used in China, and it becomes theirs. So, in other words, a lot to do with trademarks, stuff like that. If you have something that you want to sell in China, then China owns it. Is that kind of is my understanding correct of that?
Well, they own it by using the technology and the patents to replicate it. And when they do that, they infringe, where a court in the United States would find cause for infringing on someone's intellectual property, and you have patent protections for a certain time, just like we do on drugs and other technologies and therapies. They just take it, replicate it, and there's no way to enforce it. So they just steal the technology and benefit from it without having to pay the owner of that. Most of that technology is coming out of the United States. So that's just one way, Matt. I mean, they dump cheap product on the market. They manipulate mm-hmm. their currency. They mass subsidize production over there. And if you just and then you've got the intellectual property issue you talked about. There's just not anything that they have not considered doing to cheat. I don't know another way to call it.
And from that standpoint, Donald Trump's the first person who's called them out on it, as far as I can tell.
Donald Trump was the first guy to do a lot of things. Let's remember, he was the first guy in the primary to talk about border security being a national security issue. Now we've got National Guardsmen engaged in that process in a backup role. That's more than appropriate. It's necessary. Secondly, he's the first guy that talked about America first, and he tapped into that sentiment we all felt like, which was, we're not getting the kind of deal we ought to get. Why are we negotiating from weakness, and why are we letting folks take advantage of us and let international organizations like the World Trade Organization not enforce the rules of competition? So you're right on, which is why, again, I support our president 100% on both of the issues I mentioned.
Okay. So I don't want to run out of time before we talk about Syria. Now, it seems like to me one of the biggest problems we're having in Syria is Russia. What exactly can we do to stop them from killing their own people?
Well, it's a there's no words to describe how heinous that act is and how unthinkable for a government to gas their own people. You've seen the images. They're grotesque, and they're heartbreaking, especially when you're watching these kids foam at the mouth and choke, and you know that we've had dozens now killed. The president is a reluctant president when it comes to engaging in more conflict and war in the Middle East. I appreciate that. But he's also a president that is going to be decisive and be forceful in his response. We need to get the information, Matt. We need to know exactly who's involved. And then we need to be forceful. And I know this president will. The last president made arbitrary red lines and idle threats. This president has made good, actually, ironically, on the last president's threats. That's how you maintain peace through strength, the Ronald Reagan way. And I think this president is right now just taking in the information that I have no doubt he will be firm, he will be resolute, and he'll be measured given whatever information comes out. I don't want to jump to a conclusion right now, but Bashar Assad's a bad guy. Vladimir Putin is a bad guy. And we've got to show them and the rest of the world and the new bad guys that might emerge that when we say something, we mean it, and that when we act swiftly and decisively and with American strength and power. I have confidence our commander-in-chief's going to do that.
So, hey, in the time that we have left, Congressman, just a minute or so, what do you have on your mind this morning that you would like to impart to our audience?
Wow, you know what? I have a lot on my mind, especially given the issues of national security import, and I'm talking mostly about Syria because we've got this Korean Peninsula. The conflict is imminent there. I think. I think the vote that we took, that was a tough vote, and in many ways it was bad because of deficit spending, and I'm not going to defend it on that grounds, but the vote to give the troops what they need to be safe and successful, I can't tell you how important it is after being decimated for 8 years, the military cut by $200 billion, that we are restoring our strength by rebuilding the military in this last funding bill. It was a hard vote, but it was the right vote. And you've seen recently where more planes are dropping out of the sky, more troops are getting killed without even a shot fired because We don't give them the tools they need. So I am just at peace with that. We need to do a lot more. And national security, let us all remember, is the number one job of the federal government. That's not debatable.
And Congressman, is President Trump going to be able to repeal some of that bill? I mean, it sounds like to me he's looking at that possibility. Is that something that he can do?
I pray he will. I know you can. It's been done. It hasn't been done at the level we need to in terms of a rescission. But I've already been in communication with Majority Leader Kevin McCarthy while I was in West Texas the last couple weeks. And they're looking at that. And I've just said, go big. Don't be bashful, because I think the larger long-term threat is the national debt. So let's rescind and let's be fiscally responsible for the sake of our kids and grandkids, if not ourselves.
Oh.
And then, meanwhile, let's keep the military equipped to do the job.
Congressman, thank you so much for joining us this morning. We've got to run, it is about 8:29 this morning. That's going to wrap it up for us. Put a bow on the show for a Tuesday. Be back tomorrow, 6:20. Be here and join us.